Welcome to what we are celebrating as a Michigan Out of Doors family reunion. I'm Bob Garner, and I spent 13 and a half years either co-hosting or hosting this iconic show. And the show is even older than I am. And except for a couple of short absences from television, Michigan Out of Doors and Michigan Outdoors have graced the television sets of Michiganders since 1951. Like all family reunions, every member is very important. And as family reunions go, some members have passed on. Some just can't make it due to distance and schedule. But several are here tonight to celebrate this Thursday night tradition begun by the best of the best and the man we have all been measured by and who set the stage for what is one of the longest running television shows in television history, Mr. Morton F. Frankly, it's you, the audience, who are also members of this family, and we want to thank you for joining us for this Michigan Outdoors family reunion.
Michigan Out of Doors is presented by Greenstone Farm Credit Services, making recreational land ownership possible across Michigan and Northeast Wisconsin. Begin your land financing journey at one of Greenstone's 37 locations or visit greenstonefcs.com. By Meyer, a destination for hunting, fishing, and camping. From bug spray and tents to GPS and gas, Meyer has nearly everything you need to take on nature and get you there. Meyer. By G5 Outdoors, makers of the Quest and Prime bows. Manufactured and designed in Memphis, Michigan, G5 offers archery bows, broadheads, and accessories on the web at g5outdoors.com. By Country Smokehouse, offering a variety of meat products, Country Smokehouse is located 3 miles south of I-69 on M-53, just south of Imlay City. Country Smokehouse is a meat processor, a butcher, and a destination for sportsmen.
And here's a special member of our family reunion right here, Jay Neff, Mort's son Jay. It is so good to see you again. It's been a few years.
It has been a few years.
Yeah. You still get people asking about your dad and... In Michigan Outdoors?
Oh, sure I do. Unfortunately, that age of that population that asks seems to be getting older and older.
Yes, we are.
Yes, the sad reality or happy reality, I'm not quite sure which.
Now, it had to be a two-edged sword for your dad because there was no host of Michigan Outdoors better known than Mort. And so readily recognizable. I imagine that cut both ways with him.
There's that old adage about no one remembers who was second.
Yeah.
And that was kind of true with my dad. He was the pioneer with Michigan Outdoors. I mean, when they put that show on the air live back in the day.
1951.
That was it. There really weren't many outdoor television programs. And for that Detroit metro area, everything above Detroit was that wilderness. That was the north. And Dad was able to bring that into your living room so you could see what's out there. And I think that was a special thing for a lot of people.
In fact, we have one of his old cameras right here.
Mm-hmm.
I happen to own this, bought it at an auction, and feel very, very fortunate to be able to touch something your dad actually created television with.
Yeah, when we look around the room here and we see all this high technology and the lights and the video feeds, you realize that a simple piece of equipment like that is what brought Michigan Outdoors to people's living rooms. That's kind of a sobering experience, isn't it?
It certainly is. And you know, thinking about those days with your father and Howard Shelley,
mm-hmm.
who always disliked his voice. I knew Howard very well,
mm-hmm.
but Howard had the most lyrical way of telling a story. It was, mm-hmm. and that's what Dick Black mm-hmm. was part of that, Fred Trost in later years.
Mm-hmm.
But that's what those folks did best was they got it down to a common denominator of telling the story about Michigan.
About Michigan and also relating to the people of Michigan. I know that one of the things that my dad tried to do was be very much on that same level field with everybody. And I think that worked out very well. He never wanted to be seen as a star of anything. He actually kind of, I think he shoved the limelight aside. That was something that he was not interested in. But what he did was interested in is telling people's stories in the outdoor of Michigan. Whether it was somebody who said, hey, Mort, I've got this pet raccoon that keeps hanging around my porch. You got to come see it. Or this Charlie the Sandhill Crane.
Charlie the Sandhill Crane, right.
Stories like that. And that was the human interest of the day.
Or crazy grouse.
The grouse, yeah.
Yeah, crazy partridge that would get on a person's shoulder, come when it was called.
My dad actually had one that would get on his hand, and he could feed it. It was right there at our cabin in Goodhart.
And of course, Howard Shelley's the deer that came to dinner, a couple of those he did were absolutely absolutely what I remember most about Michigan Outdoors. Hey, let's take a look right now, though. Let's go to some old film and so we can hear your dad's voice a little bit.
Sure.
And go to some old film that he did down in kind of the Detroit area, down walleye fishing and I think a little muskie fishing, that sort of stuff. Mm-hmm. Down in the Detroit area, this is just great old stuff, and I could watch this all the time.
The skyline of Detroit, still another phase of springtime fishing, lures thousands to try their luck on the Detroit River in quest of walleye pike, or pickerel as they are often called here. The strong current requires a unique tackle setup. No rod is used. The lure itself is oddly shaped, sometimes called a pencil plug, and the line is handled from a spring-loaded reel clamped to the boat. A sinker of a half pound or more is on the end of the line, and above it, leaders from 12 to 40 feet long stand out in the river current. With a sinker bumping bottom, the line is chugged by hand to impart action to the lure. A fine touch is needed to feel the strike of the fish, and as the line is taken in, the automatic reel gathers it, and these Detroit River walleyes run to a choice size. The Detroit River and the St. Clair River from Port Huron to Algonac are favorite sites for this sport, and by late May, the run is normally at its peak. While walleyes of 12 and 15 pounds are taken every year in Michigan, the average in these waters is smaller, but choice for food. Within easy reach of Michigan's largest city, it is little wonder that fishing here finds so many followers each and every year. And the net results make fine picture postcard shots with that popular caption, "Wish you were here." Michigan's Lake St. Clair has been called the nation's best for muskie fishing, and as many as 2,000 of these freshwater tigers have been caught in a single year. Solid wobbling plugs or big spinners, whichever you choose, both must be preceded by powerful swivels and a heavy sinker to take the line down while trolling. You must be ready for a smashing strike as the lure runs no more than 2 or 3 feet under the water, just above the weed tops. The drag is set carefully now, and often a fish will strike only a dozen feet off the stern. From here on, your muskie is unpredictable. Some respond easily to the pressure of the rod until they get a look at the boat, and to the fisherman seeing his first muskie like this, well, the reaction may be, let's just cut the line and go home, and you can't blame him. But our first one of the day is not too large. He's lifted aboard without incident.
That was back in the early 1950s, wasn't it?
Sure.
Larry Heelan, I think, was in that with a flatfish.
I think so. I kind of vaguely recognize him there standing on the edge in that one shot, and I thought, I think that's the guy who invented that.
And one of the boats, tell me the story of one of the boats that was involved, I think, later on in the segment.
If you noticed that most of those boats, single-engine boats, and I think back in the 50s, you know, the outboard motor was brand-new technology. No one's going to have what we have today. With some of these boats have twin 300-horse, or I've even seen three 300-horse outboards on
and
boats.
And electric starts.
Yeah. But they were launching a boat and had twin outboards on it, wooden boat. And I remember as a kid, I was so fascinated with that boat. I thought, wow, look at that. It had twin outboards. Nobody had that. Well, many years later, I'm sitting at work, and I get a telephone call from a fellow. He says, hey, I think I have your dad's old boat. And so he goes to describe it to me, and a wooden lapstrake hull. I can't quite remember the name, but it was made in Michigan, twin outboards. And he found it on Craigslist, bought it, and restored it. And I thought, wow, that's fascinating. All these years later, down the road, this boat shows back up. Now, he did ask me if I wanted to buy it, but I was not interested in owning another wooden boat at the time.
Another wooden boat at that point in time. Mm-hmm. Tell me about your dad's place on the Asable. You used to get a lot of people that just dropped in there.
That was an old family home on the Asable. My great aunt, his aunt Bess, was the owner of that. And My dad, as I told you, he didn't look for the limelight.
Yes.
He didn't really want to be famous.
He tried to avoid it.
He tried to avoid it. And as the show progressed, people found out, well, this is Mort Ness Place. Well, as you know, the Osawa River gets a lot of traffic on it. Great fishing grounds. It's just an unbelievable place to fish. And people would find out which path went up to Mort Ness Place, and they began walking up that path. So my dad, after a while, really craved that, isolation.
And a little privacy.
Yeah, a little privacy. So he moved up to Goodhart and built a cabin up there right on Lake Michigan.
Did your dad have, what did he convey to you about Michigan Outdoors? Was he probably talked very little about that to you, I would imagine.
You know, some people, they ask me, wow, you must have gone hunting and fishing all the time growing up. And I usually look at them. I say, well, what does your dad do? Oh, well, my dad, he sells cars, not the local, car lot. I said, does your dad take you there on Saturdays and Sundays when he's not working? Well, no, we go hunting and fishing. I said, yeah, the reality of it is my dad, for him, it was a job. So therefore, when time came to not be working, he did other pursuits. And a lot of things that I'm interested in today, sailing was a big thing for him. He was very much into the electronics field and ham radio, something he was interested in the very early days of radio.
In fact, your dad was one of the few people that got the message, the SOS message, mm-hmm. from the Titanic.
Yes.
In what, 1913, 1912?
1912. And yes, he heard that on his crystal radio set.
He was an electronics nut.
He liked electronics from the get-go. And he built that, and it was an oatmeal can. I believe he told me it was an oatmeal can with wire around it, right? Use a crystal. And
yep.
Back in the day, there was not much for signal definition in terms of frequency. It kind of blasted out all over. And one of the things, it was a CQD, not an SOS. The precursor to the SOS was a CQD for calling distress.
Really? And mm-hmm.
He heard that.
What did he do when he heard it?
There was really nothing you could do back then, because here he was just sitting on shore in a house. I think they were living in Massachusetts at the time. And you were, wow, this is big news. And of course, all the other large radio receivers on the coast heard the same thing. So it wasn't really something that he had heard and needed to report. Everybody heard it. The important people that needed to hear it were the boats that were close to the Titanic at the time.
You know, I really have appreciated you spending this time, but one of the things we have to do is talk about since Mort came on the air, Mort Neff, 1951, some major changes took place. There was no turkey hunting. There weren't any turkeys in the state of mm-hmm. Michigan. There was moose have been introduced mm-hmm. since then. A lot of pretty successful, there was no elk hunting in the state of Michigan back then. And one of the things your dad introduced us to was this idea that a lot of people thought was a harebrained idea by the DNR to bring saltwater fish, the salmon, and put them into Lake Michigan. What would your dad think of all that now?
I was just kind of thinking when you were mentioning that, my drive down here, 4 miles from my house, I passed a flock of turkeys standing right on the side of the road.
Yep.
You know, there's never that. I regularly see bald eagles now. Out about.
They didn't
never
then.
Saw that. On I-75, here's a sign that says danger, elk crossing. So you're right, the things have changed quite a bit here in Michigan. Change is kind of inevitable, sometimes for the good, sometimes for the bad. We've seen, unfortunately, a lot of invasive species hit the Great Lakes. Not only the zebra and quagga mussels, but there's now a water flea. I was listening to a story about that yesterday, and of course, you know, we're gonna have the invasive fish species coming in. In terms of the salmon thing, I think that did provide a big boom to fishing in Michigan.
Yeah, let's stop. Can we run some of that salmon footage right now?
Well,
let's listen to your dad's
back
voice.
In 1966, for frosting on the Cape, Michigan fisheries biologists decided to add Chinook salmon to our fish bowl. These were planted as fry only a few months old, mostly in the Muskegon River. After a 3-year feeding spree in Lake Michigan, the Chinook, or king salmon as they're called on the West Coast, returned and things began to happen. Here at Nuevo, where an obsolete power dam partially blocked the river, fishermen of the big Chinook literally came face to face. The The Chinook matures at 4 years, but these younger kings gave the fishermen plenty to think about with a display of acrobatics hard to match anywhere.
Jay, one of the happiest moments sitting right here tonight that I have is not only remembering your dad, but knowing that his legacy is continuing right here on public television.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a great thing. Thanks for pulling this together and all the crew that made this happen, because this is very special.
And thank you, Jay and F, for being here to help us remember your father who began this 63-year tradition. Jerry Chipetta and Gene Little were next, and they took over the duties of Michigan Outdoors, but there was little room for this show on commercial television. And the show folded in the late 1970s, and it remained off the air until 1981, when Fred Trost and public television found a marriage of the outdoors and what had always been considered educational TV that has lasted going on two generations. Fred Trost passed away a few years ago, but joining us now is Kathy Beitler with, of all things, a fish recipe. Thank you, Kathy. So good to see you.
You too, Bob. It feels great to be back here.
You know, you haven't changed a bit.
Oh, yeah, let's talk about that.
But we need to, well, there's a lot of things we need to talk about, but the first thing we're going to do is this recipe, because this is a humdinger.
Yes, it is. It's a fish recipe and has sour cream, cream cheese, salt and pepper, and Worcestershire. Liquid
Worcestershire sauce, yeah.
Old Bay seasoning, a little bit of garlic diced finely, some onion diced finely, and of course your fish. And we're going to use walleye for this recipe.
Hey, Donna, see the piece of skin on it? You caught that.
I did.
Or one of your kids did, or
granddaughter. Yeah, granddaughter.
In Canada.
Yep, Bob and I went to Canada with Kelsey and her boyfriend and family this summer and caught walleye, pike, and perch.
I love the way you measure out the Old Bay here.
Still way, yeah. That's the only way to do it.
Get a handful, throw it in, right?
Some Old Bay seasoning, and I think Old Bay makes any fish recipe just taste better. Whether I'm frying fish or boiling it or deep frying, it just tastes better. You're gonna put your walleye, of course, in for 6 to 7 minutes in boiling water. And you don't want to overdo it. You can actually overdo fish in boiling water.
Even in boiling water.
Yes. And then you're going to let it sit for a little bit and then just flake it up.
Now, this was one of the recipe winners from the old recipe contest we had.
It was a recipe contest, but I kind of tweaked it with the Old Bay.
Of course. Oh, the cream
and
cheese.
And liquid smoke.
The cream cheese.
Right,
I could eat that stuff alone, you know?
Everybody can. And it has this cream cheese and sour cream. And you can put this in a blender to mix it up better, but then you gotta dig it all out of the blender. So we're just gonna mix it up in a bowl and mix it really good.
And then add your onion.
You can never have enough onion, in my opinion.
Yep.
And some chopped garlic, of course. And
never enough of that either.
Right,
keep
exactly.
Keep the vampires away, you know.
And then there's your Worcestershire sauce. then you're just gonna add a little bit of salt and pepper. And then going to mix this all up good. And the key is getting it all blended really good before you add the fish.
But it does help when you flake that walleye up,
oh,
right?
Oh, absolutely. And it's the walleye, when it's still just a little bit warm, will kind of make it blend easier, kind of melt that cream cheese a little bit, soften it up a little bit. And then you mix this all up and let it set. The longer it sets, the better it tastes. If it sets at least 4 hours or more, it's going to taste a little bit better. And then you can serve it with crackers or baguette or whatever you want. Vegetables would be great with it, of course, you know, your broccoli, celery. But we're going to go with crackers.
Of course, you have crackers. All I need is a spoon, Kath.
Well, we have a little knife here. Okay. So.
Can we try this?
You know, absolutely.
The crew is sitting out here just waiting to get
this
stuff. So, anyway, I'm going to go ahead and try it. And perhaps, could I make one for you, sweetie
pie?
Oh,
would you?
Yes,
that would be different.
And I'm not going to put too much on because I'd like a lot for myself. No, that's not true. Kathy, in remembering, the recipe was such a big part of of when Fred Trost, the guy was a genius.
Oh, he was, absolutely.
And brought this all back to public television. And we took a little guff over the recipe segment of the show.
But the truth
of the matter is we got far more requests for recipes than anything else about the show.
Oh, I think Fred was a forerunner in all of the cooking shows that are on today, actually. We did them did this recipe, and there was no other show really that did a recipe on the show. And now they have the cooking shows and cooking channel, but I think that actually he brought that to the forefront. I really do.
And one of the great memories I have of joining the Michigan Outdoors show at that point in time is Ed Gross.
Oh, yeah.
What a class act.
Oh, definitely.
And the
definitely.
Ford boys, John and James Ford.
Yeah, Joanne Cribley, who worked on the magazine and stuff.
And Tim Zico, who directed it for years, was in the studio watching as we recorded this.
Yeah.
And they had to leave. But anyway, what a great bunch of folks we worked with at WKR at MSU.
And, you know, if it hadn't been for Fred and that show, I wouldn't have met a lot of the friends that I have that I consider friends today. You know, they were just, they really are. They're just good friends, you know, and because of Fred.
And with all of these friends we made and with all of the contacts we made over the years, it just was something that will always be a highlight of my life.
Oh, definitely. I agree. I totally agree. You know, I used to say those were the best days of my life, and they career-wise were. But now every day I wake up, it's a good day.
You know what, Kathy? It's an absolute great day when you can come in here and do a recipe and let us reminisce a little bit about some fun times. You remember that we brought the live bear in the studio that time?
Yes.
That's a story I will never forget. And the bear attacked Fred.
Yes.
Knocked him right over on his keister, sitting there on a bench. Knocked him right over, and the bear was after chewing gum that he had in his pocket.
Yep.
The bear could smell it. And so this 350-pound black bear knocked him right over. And when I go back to WKR, they still remember that. They still remember that story.
Yeah,
Kathy, it is so good to see you.
You also.
And so wonderful. Life's good?
Yeah, well,
you
great.
And Bob are
fantastic.
Doing fine
fantastic.
Up in Grayling?
We're living in Grayling. Absolutely love it. The grandkids are growing. Our granddaughter is going to be a wildlife biologist. Grandson graduates this year. I mean, doesn't get any better.
It pretty much is perfect.
And
thank
Anders
you.
Is
Anders
growing.
Is doing fine. Yeah, Anders, you know, grew up with Michigan Outdoors. He's
right.
Doing fine. I got two grandsons that are just carrying BB guns everywhere they go.
As it should be.
And a lovely daughter-in-law. And Beth is perfect. It is
marvelous.
All good.
Great.
It is all good. Thanks for being part of the reunion.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kathy Beitler. Seeing old friends and sharing memories of this Michigan Outdoors family is really a thrill for me. Remembering sitting around the television set on Thursday nights with my dad and mom and my brothers makes me think of how lucky I was to grow up with this show, and then even luckier still to host it. Thanks to public television, it's still on Thursday nights, and it's still all about Michigan. Now stay tuned as some of the best Michigan Outdoors memories and some of my favorite folks of Michigan Outdoors are yet to come. Michigan Outdoors continued until 1992. In March of 1993, I re-entered the picture, and with the help of Abby Burke and James Ford, brought Michigan Outdoors back to public television. Michigan United Conservation Clubs owned the show, and we called it Michigan Out of Doors to match their magazine's name. But the aim of this show was to stay true to the outdoors and the format that Mort Neff introduced us to 42 years earlier. Now here's a much younger and thinner Bob Garner, and less gray, I might add, introducing that first show in March of 1993. Welcome to our show. This week, Ab, we have reports that were more fun to do than anything I can remember in a long time.
It was such a weekend. I tell you, we were turkey hunting, smelt dipping, and talking to the beagles.
A report on beagles and bunnies and field trial, and we've got the wildlife show. Going to be a tremendous show, so let's get started. here we are today with the current host of Michigan Out of Doors, Jimmy Gretzinger. Of course, Jimmy, so great to have you here. And
good to be here. It's a lot of fun.
And Jenny Olson. Has this been a hoot seeing it thus far?
This is awesome. It's a blast from the past. I see a few food stains on this table, and we probably all saw when they happened on television.
They did, although you may not be old enough to remember back when I got started on television. But yeah, there are quite a few food stains and a lot of memories sitting around
this table. I like seeing you with the full beard. It's all dark and you're young. I mean, how old were you at that point? You weren't.
When I first started with Fred Trost in the old Michigan Outdoor Show, I was not yet 30.
Wow.
And I'm in my 60s now. So it has been a long time and a good run. But some really amazing things happened along that run. One, Kathy Beitler came in during the Fred Trost years, and she had a steady gig as preparing a recipe every week, which kind of categorized. But it was the first time a woman was seen on TV in an outdoor show, every week. And that was a very cool thing. Then Abby Burke, when I brought back Michigan Out of Doors to public television, I insisted we have a female co-host. And I think that was for all the better. Abby Burke, then Claudia Hitchcock, and then who came after Claudia? That was
this one right here.
Yeah, but there was one.
Replaced Claudia, but then I left, and Kelly Gotch came. And then I came back.
Right, yep. And the women of Michigan Outdoors have always been just gorgeous too, and you certainly no exception, Jenny Olson. Jenny, as a matter of fact, you have a lot of memories of this show. How long have you been doing this?
I started in 1999, so it's been 15 years ago that I started, but I did, I think, five and a half years, and I left for a little while, went down to Texas, tried working for Ted Nugent for a little bit, and got terribly homesick and came back, and in that time, Kelly had come on and worked for a few years, and then she moved on, and Jimmy called to see if I wanted my old job back, and I said, heck yes, I do.
Yeah, and that was right about the time that I was kind of purchasing the show from MUCC,
right?
So it was... The transition worked, Jenny was coming back to Michigan, and we needed a new co-host, so it fit perfect, and we were glad to have her back.
Got the old co-host instead of a new one.
Yeah, the new old co-host.
Oh, I think there's never been a more perfect co-host Abby Burke did a great job for the years she was there. Claudia Hitchcock, tremendously talented individual,
yep.
And really never knew Kelly.
Yeah, they've all been
except
great.
From the show. But I know of no one who fits this show like an old shoe better than you do. I mean, and that's a compliment. That is a compliment because there's a lot of tradition and a lot of reason for us to want to do well, to keep up that Morton F. Attitude or persona about the show, and you do it well.
Well, it's so fun to do. Like you said, carrying on that tradition and telling other people's stories every week. And I remember one of the first times I ever got to sit down and talk to you and get to know you and spend a little time with you, Bob. That's one of the things you said to me. Just keep telling the story. Tell a good story. And I remember that almost
really?
Every time I edit and write a script to narrate a story. I remember that.
Really?
Yeah. It's good advice.
Well, thank you. But I just hope I could hold true to it myself. So, hey, tell us about one of your favorite stories.
It's so hard to pick. You guys have to agree. I mean, thinking back through all the years, it was mind-boggling. And my mind couldn't get past the last few years. But it's fun, I think we all agree, meeting the new people and hearing everyone's different stories across the state every week. But what's become something that I cherish quite a bit these days, Jimmy and his wife Dana have become very dear friends over the last 15 years too. And being able to spend time with Jimmy on a shoot, that doesn't happen very often. We're usually off in two separate directions every week. So the story that I picked it because I remember we laughed so hard on this trip. We were salmon fishing out of Frankfurt just a few summers ago. It was Jimmy and his wife, Dana. We had an extra spot on the boat, so I invited my friend Christy Wodek.
Known since first grade?
First grade.
Oh,
and we had a blast.
That's like first grade's like 15 years ago,
oh,
right?
Oh, absolutely.
Hey, let's take a look at that segment now.
I think this is the first time all summer you and I have been on the same trip.
That's
kind
right.
Of fun.
This is your first salmon fishing trip of the year, isn't it?
I'm afraid it is, yeah. Today we've got one of my lifelong childhood friends, Christy Wodek. We were in the same first grade class together. But Christy, amazingly, even though she grew up in Ortonville, where myself and Kelly Gotch both grew up, she's never been out salmon fishing. So she lives in Traverse City now, and We had an extra spot on the boat and thought we'd get her out here to haul one in. So we'll see how that goes.
Yeah. So you're going to show her the ropes here?
I guess I'm going to.
Well, we were not far south of the Frankfurt Pier when we found our first fish. Jenny was up to bat first to show our less familiar fishermen how it's done.
Right. Could be the only fish. Highly doubt it. The way Greg's talking, this is the first of many.
That's right. That was on a high diver, about 185 out. So roughly, if that's 3-1, you're looking at like 60 feet. Roughly, yeah. Yep. Roughly, so, which is nice because we're seeing a lot of fish in there, so hopefully they're gonna go.
And then we're in kind of a hole on here?
Yep, so we're in the inner shelf on the herring hole, so we're really close to shore in here, 108 feet of water. We're gonna work this like a big C, and we're gonna go all the way around and come back. Usually, towards night, they really go in here, so cross our fingers.
Like most evening trips for Greg, we found some very nice fish holding here in this large hole just south of Frankfurt.
That is a king salmon.
Heck yeah. Beautiful, beautiful.
Can we take a picture?
Oh, sure.
We were finding a few fish, and we had skirted the storms that had blown through earlier in the day, and we really weren't sure how that would affect the fish. We had a strong east wind, but as that died with the setting sun, the fish seemed to turn on a bit. We were losing a lot of fish, not because of the anglers, just the fish were biting a bit short. But luckily, we had several attempts and even a few doubles to help even out the score.
Nice job. Yay.
You know, it's funny, Jenny. You have to cherish the old friends.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
And you can make a lot of old friends very quickly when you do this show like you have. Now, Jimmy, you came on
in the fall of 1998.
And James Ford,
yes,
was hosting the show then. I had retired.
Yeah, it was the year that you retired. I came in as the low man on the totem pole and. Worked for probably 2 or 3 years with James, and then he moved on, and then I moved into that executive producer slot. And in fact, it was the show 0943 was the first show that I worked on, and we just did 1443. So it's been, I just finished 16 years of doing the show.
But I think, you know, and of course, Gabe Van Warmer has been just a great
been
addition
with us,
always.
Jordan Brown, James Ford, all those guys that, you know, everybody has their own way of, you know, telling a story, like Jenny alluded to earlier, which is really at the heart, I think, of what made Michigan Out of Doors so special over the years, because the technology has changed a ton from Mort and film days into what you guys did into what we're using now. But, you know, if you can stay true to telling a story and showing people this great old state of Michigan, you know,
there is none better.
It's a format that works. And without, you know, I just want to say without Mort and Fred and Jerry Gepetta and you, Bob, you know, we wouldn't have the jobs that we do. We wouldn't be able to travel the state and have all the fun that we get to without what you guys have done before. So I just want to, you know, hats off to all that you guys did.
And when you go right back to it, it was all more. It's kind of an easy formula to stay true to, isn't it?
Yeah, and I think it's nice because, you know, even when Mort was doing it and Fred, they were on camera probably a little bit more than what we are.
Yeah.
But they were never, hey, look at me, it's all about me. They were always pointing the camera at the sportsmen and women of the state of Michigan, and that's why it works. Because if it was every week watching me fish or watching you fish or Jenny,
yeah,
it just gets old quick. But when you can tell other people's story, you can do 100 different bluegill stories and they're all different because everybody has a story to tell.
And you know what's really neat about it is you and Jenny have really found the essence, in my view, of Michigan Outdoors, Michigan Out of Doors, whatever we call it, it's all the same thing. You have really found the essence of it in this next piece that we're gonna watch, which is one of your favorite pieces, really tells the whole thing. A good bird hunt with a guy like Sheldon McBurney, who is one of the class acts in this world.
He is, and it's one of my favorite things is bird dogs and bird hunting shotguns and all that kind of stuff. So part of that is why I love the story so much, but one of the greatest things about working with Michigan Out of Doors is meeting sportsmen from around the state. And Sheldon McBurney just kind of exemplifies, you know, the old timer who's done it all. And when you can just sit in the woods and listen to those guys tell stories, it doesn't get much better than that. That's why This Is Hunt was one of my
favorites. I know all three people involved in this story. Let's take a look at it.
I'll try to get it your way. Got the birds and everything.
Look at that. Nice job. Yeah, how often does that happen where you get to see him like that?
Yeah, if you look quite often, really.
Oh, yeah?
On woodcraft, yeah.
Well, good shot, young fella.
Thank you.
Having a good pointing dog is a luxury most of us hope to have at least once in a lifetime. Randy and Sheldon both have had several, and whether it's a rock hard point or a great retrieve, they are very special. As we pause for another quick break, Sheldon told me something that he does each and every day.
On the edge of the bed and just look up and say, thanks for giving me another day. That's the honest guy's truth. That's what I do.
And this is birthday what number?
80. Big 80.
Big 80. And you're out here hunting birds today.
Yep.
Shot a limited woodcock, too.
Right. At least Randy says that.
Oh.
I gotta put that in there.
It had to be you.
Randy, how long have you been hunting with Sheldon?
Oh, I've been hunting with Sheldon since about 91, 92, hunting and banding. He's the one that really taught me a lot about both. It's been an honor and pleasure to hunt with him. A blessing, too, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
There ain't too many guys that's old enough to be your dad that, I shouldn't have said that, but is that serious a hunter.
That doesn't bother me.
And it's
man.
Been, well, it's only been the last 5 or 6 years I've been able to stay up with him. Usually he's waiting for him.
There are many guys like Randy who are better people for knowing and hunting with Sheldon McBurney. Many of you may have a guy like him in your life that was instrumental in getting you into the outdoors. Don't let another season go by without telling them thanks.
It's funny how fast the time goes, you know, and taking time cues here and getting a chance to talk. We could have done this for a couple of hours. I mean, and how hard was it you picking out a favorite story?
It is really hard to pick out a favorite story. You think, you know, we're doing 52 shows a year over 16 years. I can't do the math, but it's a lot of stories. And it's hard to pick one.
Jimmy, and it's important to point out right now that you are, next to Morton F., the second longest in longevity on Michigan Outdoors in the 63-year history of it.
Mm.
You've even got more time doing this show than Howard Shelley had.
Wow.
And I greatly admire you. You know, as far as I'm concerned, the show's much closer to the old Morton F. show now, because of how technology's changed, than anything we were able to do in the intervening years.
Well, technology has changed it a lot. You know, even when I started with Michigan Out of Doors, what we could do then to what we can do now, and the size of the cameras and the computers, and it's easier in some ways, it's harder in some ways. Back, you know, when you were doing the show, there was, what, 3 channels on TV, and now there's, you know, 3,000, and there's like 3 or 4 that are all outdoor shows.
Three channels. Thanks for bringing that up, Jim. Actually, there was 4, because where I live, we also got the CKLW.
Oh, there you go.
Out of Canada.
You know, it's changed the way we had to do outdoor TV, because back then, there was no template. It was just Michigan Outdoors, and that was it. And then now, you know, there's all these different channels that people can go to, but I think what has made Michigan Outdoors different from all that stuff is what you guys are trying to stay true to that formula, pace, and variety. Stay here in the state of Michigan, tell the stories that are, you know, there's just so many of them, and to try to do it week after week after week. I think that, you know, most of the outdoor shows that you see do 13 episodes or 26, and we're doing 52. So we're a different animal, and covering the state, there's always plenty of stories to tell.
Yeah, I don't know if I told you the story or not, but years ago, when I was called the field producer for Michigan Outdoors, I used to think, I laid out all the shows I wanted to do. I used to think in a year and a half I could have them all done. It's never a problem finding something to do in this great old state, is it?
That's crazy. And people ask us a lot, like, don't you run out of ideas? And like Jimmy said earlier, you could do 20 different bluegill fishing stories, and they're all different because you're with different people telling a different story. So.
And the viewers, you know, we get a lot of our stories from people calling in. That's how we get a lot of new things, which I'm sure, you know, when you were doing the show, people are calling in all the time.
All the time.
Oh, come here, do this, do that. And so, you know, the viewers play a big part in the show. Kind of has a life of its own, and it kind of tells you sometimes what, you know, what's current and what people
want
to see.
Yeah, it's not our show. It's, you know, Michigan's show.
Well, exactly the point. I have a favorite show segment that I wanted to show in all of this. But the truth of it is, we're running out of time. So let's forget the favorite show and let's just talk about this great opportunity, because it has changed all of our lives.
It really has. I mean, I think we've, you know, grown up doing this. I was in my late 20s when I started this, and now in my early 40s. And, you know, just to travel the state and to be able to meet the sportsmen and women all around the state, and a lot of which are some of my, you know, best friends now. Randy Strauss, that was just on that last
sure.
bird hunt. I hunt with Randy
old friend of mine.
Several times a year, and I met him you know, just starting out with Michigan Out of Doors. So, and, yeah, just the friendships and the every little town you go to, all the neat little, you know, the you know, restaurants and bars and places around the state. There's just too many stories to tell.
You can't. I've hunted or fished in all 83 counties in Michigan, okay? Mm. And there isn't any little town I can't drive through that I'd think I'd have stopped and have coffee with this guy or that gal, you know,
right,
somebody I've met along the way.
Well,
isn't it, it's fun, isn't it?
Guys, I'm sure you've both heard this too, but everywhere we go, people tell us, you're so lucky. You have the best job in the world. And it's true. And I think we're all very fortunate to have been able to make our careers doing this, but it's just so much fun to be able to do it, and it's an honor to be a part of the tradition and help carry this on.
Hey, I want to thank personally everyone from Morton F. On that has given such good service to this show. Everybody contributed, and everybody that ever worked on this show, along with those of us who were both viewers and active in this production, were left with a greater love for this great old state of Michigan, and there is none better, no siree. But none of this could have happened without Morton F., and make no mistake about this, it could not continue without our local public television stations. So stick around.